Welcome to First Christian Church Fayetteville. We are glad that you're joining us for worship today, and we have just a couple of announcements before we begin. First of all, we're looking for updated photos to use during our online worship service. If you have pictures that you'd like to share of yourself or your family, maybe having communion or a meal together, playing at the park or out hiking, or maybe participating in a Sunday supper or other outreach, please email those to the church office so we can use them. Then we want to give a great big thank you to everyone who cooked and provided the meal for Seven Hills Homeless Center on Friday, and to give a shout out to our youth group and their sponsors who are cooking and serving dinner tonight for the Sunday supper community meal at Trinity Methodist. Thank you for continuing our outreach in the community, even in the midst of a pandemic. We appreciate you so much. Our call to worship this morning is adapted from Psalm 62. For God alone is our rock and our salvation, our fortress. We shall not be shaken. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. For God is a refuge for us. Come, let us worship our Lord.
As we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever, our hope, our strong God, you do not faint, you won't.
ABC. God is love and thus redeems us in the Christ we crucified. This is God's eternal answer to the world's eternal why. May we in this faith adore, be content to live and die.
You pray with me. Everlasting God, you give us strength. You deliver us from trouble and give us hope each new day the sun rises. You are our rock and refuge. When the water rises, when the wind blows, when the job is lost, when the job is found, when we grieve, when we rejoice, you're always there. We trust in you alone, God, and our faith and our lives rest on a foundation that cannot be shaken, because we've witnessed time and time again that your power and your steadfast love never ends for us. God, we hardly have language to express how grateful we are for your presence with us. It's hard to comprehend that the very author of the universe would hear our prayers, and yet you do. Thank you, God. Thank you for our recent church board retreat and meeting, and for leaders who care so much about your church and want to use their gifts to serve you. We ask that you bless our new church year and guide us with wisdom in all our planning and all our doing. We lift up prayers for people in Alabama who are dealing with the aftermath of a tornado and those in California who, after months of wildfires, are now inundated with too much rain and mudslides. Be their refuge and strength through these trying times. In our church family, we continue to pray for Chris and Bob as they mourn the loss of Diane, and as they make arrangements for her service in this difficult time to plan final goodbyes. We lift up all who are coping with health issues and need your healing mercies. Among them, Artie, who we learned recently broke a bone in her arm. And Lauren, you know that COVID is on our minds every day. We ask that you especially give wisdom and guidance to all the people trying to coordinate how to get more vaccines distributed and into people's arms. We long for the day when we can no longer be concerned about this virus or hear about it in the news. Be near to us and grant us patience and the strength that we need till we arrive at that day. In each of our many prayers, spoken and unspoken, we lift them up to you. In the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The peace of Christ makes fresh my heart, a fountain ever springing. All things are mine since I am his. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost.
sorrows come, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and death, how can I keep from singing?
Today's scripture reading comes from Psalm 62. Song of trust in God alone. For God alone my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress, I shall never be shaken. How long will you assail a person? Will you batter your victim, all of you, as you would a leaning wall, a tottering fence? Their only plan is to bring down a person of prominence. They take pleasure in falsehood. They bless with their mouths, but inwardly they curse. For God alone my soul waits in silence, for my hope is from him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress, I shall not be shaken. On God rests my deliverance and my honor, my mighty rock. My refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. Those of low estate are but a breath. Those of high estate are a delusion. In the balances they go up, they are together lighter than a breath. Put no confidence in extortion and set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. Once God has spoken, twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God, and steadfast love belongs to you, O Lord, for you repay to all according to their work. This ends the reading of the Holy Word. What a blessing these last few weeks have been as elders from this congregation have been sharing personal reflections of their journey with God. Their journey with God as they've made difficult decisions or had to go through very difficult times. My challenge to the elders this month was, can you tell us some stories, share some reflections of how God has held you, especially as we go through these difficult times? I know it's been a blessing to me. I hope it's been a blessing to you. I really look forward to what our elders have to share this day. Be blessed.
Hello, I'm Sharon Michaels, one of the elders at First Christian Church in Fayetteville. This month, Pastor Ryan has asked the elders to share when we feel God's presence. My story is about my parents. So 15 years ago, my mother announced to our family that she had been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. Wow, I did not want this for my family or for her. I knew it'd be hard on all of us, especially my mom. She was our calm in the storms of life. My mom was my Christian mentor and best friend. I could talk with her about my problems with people or situations. Mom had a way of listening and asking questions so that at the end of our conversation, I was able to see another side of the problem. And with her encouragement, I usually realized I needed to pray for the situation or the person. With my brother and his family in Texas, it was mostly my dad who took care of mom the first few years. And I would come up to help on the weekends and during the summer when I wasn't teaching. It was a very difficult time, with mom needing more guidance and help, and dad needing to vent, so I was the one he poured his frustrations on. After about 4 years, I encouraged my dad to consider moving my mom to a memory care facility. It took some time to convince him that it was best for them both, and we found a wonderful facility close by called the Meadows. My dad went every day to visit with her and sit with her, and talk with her, eat lunch with her, and sing to her. He even joined an Alzheimer's dementia support group for family members and ended up becoming very involved in that. Watching them together was like catching a glimpse of them when they were young and first in love. His loving care of her was a reflection of God's command to love others as we love ourselves. It was quite a lesson. Though she rarely spoke, Mom would join us in with us as we sang familiar songs. It was wonderful to hear her voice this way. Within a few years, she struggled to walk, feed herself, and take care of her personal needs. We knew it was time to move her to a retirement nursing home nearby where Dad could visit. These were hard times, watching her become silent and her mind slip away. Mom was usually happy and compliant with us, but she no longer acknowledged who we were or said our names. On my drive home after visiting with her, I spent many times in tears, either angry with God or sad, but always talking to God. It just seemed like it would never end. I continue to remind my mom that Jesus loved her, that he was with her and had a place prepared for her. Then in the spring of 2015, we got a call that Mom was close to the end of her life. The last time I visited my mom, I crawled up in bed with her and I laid with her, which I did occasionally, telling her how much I loved her. I did say that I just didn't think I could come visit her again. It was just so hard seeing her like that. But I knew she understood. I also reminded her that she could leave anytime and go with Jesus to heaven. Well, that evening, she did leave with Jesus. I was so happy when I found out, so thankful that she was whole again with family and friends. Looking back now, I believe God was with me by leading me to talk with Mom about her faith, reminding her how much Jesus loved her and was always with her, that Jesus would take care of her and bring her to heaven. I wanted her to have that assurance like she always gave me. Sometime after Mom's passing, I remember hearing or reading about seasons of life, that our hard times only last a season. I knew that was what we had just endured, the hard season of Alzheimer's with Mom. Reminding myself that this was only a season has helped me during hard times since. Life continued and was somewhat easier. I still visited with Dad on the weekends and during the summer, taking Dad on day trips and making sure we spent time with local family. 2 years ago in January 2019, my dad was still living on his own and doing fairly well for 90 years old. Well, he slipped and fell in his bathroom, broke his hip, and was on the floor for 46 hours before he was found. He told me it was a life-changing experience and he had talked with God much of the time. Before this, he refused to wear a life alert button, but since he became a big advocate. A week later, during my morning devotionals, God seemed to say, "Why don't you retire so you can spend more time with your dad?" I was surprised. My first thought was, "Well, we can't afford that." And God's answer was, "I'll take care of you. I'll take care of your needs." I really liked the idea, but I was scared, I can tell you. Well, Dad decided that spring to transition to a residential assisted living facility and ended up going to the same one Mom had been at. Downsizing and moving everything out of his house was a nightmare. They had stuff since the beginning of their marriage. And of course, he wanted to keep the majority of it. So we crammed a lot of it in that little apartment that he had. And he enjoyed it. He enjoyed setting everything up. As I retired, I decided I could sub-teach. That would help supplement our income. Even though I still spent time with my dad on the weekends, I subbed during the week. Then in December, I was able to sub just a few days a week. And I started helping Dad with his memoir, typing it out like a secretary. I took him to the store, and he still drove. He drove himself to church, usually, and sometimes to doctor appointments, but usually he had me do that. Then March of 2020, COVID came, and I could no longer visit him like we had. I also could no longer subteach, so I had to trust God yet again with our finances. And by the way, we're doing just fine. Thank you, God. I continued spending time with my dad, although I couldn't do it there. I could visit outside. We were outside with masks, and I was 6 feet apart. I could take him to the store and to medical appointments. And I finally convinced him to sell his car May 2020, which was a good thing. So we had weekly or biweekly visits outside. And he kept telling me his doctor said, I'm going to live to 100. And you know, his mind was still very active and alert. Yet he was frustrated because his body was falling apart. He had macular degeneration, so it was hard for him to see. He had a hearing loss, so he was supposed to wear hearing aids, which he had, but he didn't use very often. And he was moving much slower, having to depend on a walker because of his broken hip. In September of 2020, all retirement facilities really cracked down and were really strict with family contact. So when Dad had surgery on his head for a skin melanoma, I was glad I was able to stay with him in the hospital. And everything went well. In October of 2020, Dad was having trouble breathing when he was walking. But it got better after his doctor prescribed medication for fluid retention. Then in November, he started feeling bad again, but he really didn't like telling people. He didn't like telling the nurse or the aides that he needed help, even though he did. And this time, his heart and kidneys were not doing well. The nurse kept me posted on Dad's condition and kept his doctor in the loop. On Thanksgiving Day, because of COVID, our family decided we couldn't see each other, and I knew I couldn't see my dad. I planned on calling him, but it was around noon that I got a call, and I thought, oh, Dad's calling me. No, it was the nurse at the Meadows telling us that he was on his way to the emergency room because he wasn't doing well. So we got in the car and raced up there, and I got to spend Thanksgiving with my dad in the emergency room. Bob had to stay out in the car. He was admitted that evening, and the great thing was I was allowed to go visit him every day between the hours of 3 and 7. When I was in his hospital room, it was closer than I'd ever been to him physically. So I was able to hold his hand, kiss him goodbye, sing to him, talk with him. Sometimes I was quiet because a lot of the times, he was just tired or dozing or not doing well, not feeling well. I remember praying to God and telling him, do you remember how much my dad doesn't like to feel helpless? He doesn't like needing anybody's help. And that if it's time for my dad to leave, I sure would like it if he could leave before he had to stay in a nursing home in a helpless situation, because he just wouldn't like that. Then I remembered that it's really not up to me when God chooses to take someone home. And I told God, I said, it's up to you. You take him when you want him. You have his time in your hands. And if he's still got lessons to learn and people to help, then keep him here. But you know how I feel. So I trust your decision and plan for my dad. That was my prayer. Well, on December 7th, my dad was admitted to hospice in the evening, late afternoon. And early the next morning on Tuesday at 5:30, Jesus took him home to heaven. Kind of typical for my dad. He was an early riser. How did I feel? Just like Mom, I was so thankful that he was taken to heaven. I knew that he could see again, he could hear again, run and jump and feel good. He could see my mom and my brother and other family members and friends and spend his first Christmas with Jesus. I realized it was a season. It ended sooner than I thought it would, but it ended exactly when God designed it to end. I'm so thankful I retired and spent more time with my dad. The great thing is Dad had planned everything for his funeral, for his time after he passed, and everything has gone so smoothly. And as of last weekend, all this stuff is taken care of now. I felt God's presence with me and my dad during the whole hospital stay. I felt God's presence afterwards. I still know God is with me. It's still scary to let go and trust God, but I know that God will take care of me, especially in the difficult times. Matthew 11:28-30 states, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. For me, this means that I'm to let go and trust God to take care of me and guide me. That's when I'll find rest for my soul. I hope you find rest for your soul, and I hope you know that God is always with you. Blessings."
Hi, I'm Cheryl Seibrandt, and if we haven't met before, I am the Associate Minister at First Christian Church here in Fayetteville.
And I'm Doug Seibrandt. I'm currently an elder at First Christian Church, and we've been going to the church for about 33 years, about as long as we've been married.
Yeah, one of the things that I get to do is to attend the elder meetings on Thursdays, but Doug's working at that time and can't make it then. So when Pastor Ryan asked if elders might share their story, just about a time when God held them through a difficult situation, I, of course, threw Doug under the bus because he wasn't there at the meeting. But it did make me think right off of a time not so long ago when Doug didn't have a job to be working at. And you know, financial issues aren't something that people really feel comfortable talking about a lot of times. There's, I think, some pride and or embarrassment and wrapped up in it. And also for Doug, maybe some loss of identity and status. And as a minister, I can say that I am much more comfortable listening to other people's pain or struggles than probably sharing my own. So it's a area of growth, I guess you could say, for me. But I do think that it's so important just for all of us to trust that we can be vulnerable with one another. And obviously we support each other in good times and bad times. So that's why we decided to share our story.
When I was a teenager, it was the summer of my 11th grade year, I started working in the textbook industry. And I worked for one company for probably 23 years or so. And, you know, it's a traditional story. I started at the bottom, you know, working in the mailroom. And by the time the company closed down, I was working with a network of a couple hundred independent book vendors for us. And, you know, it was not just a place of work. It's where you had lots of friends. And we hung out with a lot of the people that we knew down there. Our kids hung out. We went camping. It was a good place, good job. The owner decided to retire back in 2012, and he tried to sell the company, but was unable to. So about 300 of us were suddenly unemployed. And it was a tough time, but my old boss was able to find employment in the textbook industry in Kentucky. And he called me up one day and said, "Hey, Doug, you know, we could probably use you here. Fly out here and talk to us." So I did. And they didn't want to hire me and wanted us to move out to Kentucky. But at that time, my parents were in poor health, so I didn't think it would be a good move. And, you know, our church family was here and all our friends, and we really just didn't want to leave Northwest Arkansas. So I was able to convince them that I could give it a try here and work from home. And it worked out pretty good. I worked for them for, you know, another 7 years in the textbook industry business. And was able to be home when the kids got up in the morning, got on the bus, and when they got off the bus in the afternoons, I was here. So it worked out really well. But the textbook industry also changed, and I lost my position. Now, I found this out in 2019, weeks before Cheryl's ordination. And actually, it was, I officially got let go 3 days after her ordination, so it was a trying time for us.
Oh my God, what are you trying to tell us?
again, I found myself, I was unemployed, and it took 5 months for me to find another job in the summer of 2019. Mm-hmm. And I was able to finally get a job in the logistics industry. It wasn't the best fit for me. I wasn't used to making anywhere from 80 to 100 cold calls per day, but it was tolerable.
For a paycheck.
And then the spring of 2020 rolled around and COVID hit, and they had to start working from home. And a lot of the businesses that I had built up they were smaller businesses, and they started having issues with inventory as far as being able to get supplies in or be able to ship out, and everything just slowed down. So everything was changing. And then there was one day, it was a nice spring day.
April day.
Well, end of April. we were sitting outside eating our lunch, and I told Cheryl, I said, "It's so nice. I just wish we could go fishing." And about 10 minutes later, I got a phone call from my boss, and he said he had HR on the other line, and they decided to eliminate several positions and give our book of business to the other employees that they wanted to keep. So I found myself yet once again unemployed in May of 2020, which is definitely not the best time to be looking for a job. We'll say starting over from scratch in your 50s is very humbling. Your salary, it won't be as strong as it was working in an industry that you had been in for, 30 years. So for 4 months, I went and drew unemployment and was looking for work. Had several interviews, but finally, I was hired on by a solid company, and willing to give me a chance, kind of start over in a brand new industry and a brand new career.
So, between 2019 and mid 2020, Doug was unemployed twice during that time for a total of about 9 months. Mm-hmm. So, our rainy day savings was completely dried up. We had two kids in college and one still at home, but in spring 2020, as everybody knows, college students were back home due to the pandemic, and now we're a household of five living on one salary and an unemployment check, and the loss of income really affected the dynamic for our whole family. It put a strain on my and Doug's relationship. Because I guess you could say we really approached the job loss in such different ways. I wanted to be supportive and understanding, I think I was most of the time, but I know there were days when I definitely was not, and Doug probably dreaded me just walking in the door because he knew I'd ask, "Hey, any luck in the job search today, honey?" But unemployment kept us afloat. But we were scared and just praying that we didn't have any major home repairs or car repairs, that nobody got sick or had to go to the hospital. There was just enough to cover the bills. So when Doug lost his jobs, we also lost health insurance coverage and found ourselves just looking through the government marketplace. And in that 1 year, we probably had, remembering right, 4 or 5 insurance changes to deal with. And anybody who knows me knows how much I love paperwork. So it was not a happy time in the Cybrand household. But after a while, you come to this place, I guess in the unemployment road, when you question if you'll be able to provide for your family's security. And that really makes you do some soul searching. You know, you can look at your faith and you can turn on God. Like, God, why don't you fix this? Or, God, don't you care? Or, why is this happening to us? And how long is it going to last? Where you can turn to God and just as a fortress through the storm. When you don't know how you're going to meet and pay for your own shelter and needs, it really brings you to a deeper understanding of who your provider is and who your hope's in. And really, if you think about it, it's not, your hope's not in yourself or even your spouse. And you can rely on yourself and do your best to find a job, but it's not really who your provider is. Psalm 62 says, "For my hope is from God. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my deliverance and my honor. My mighty rock, my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times, O people," including the Cyberans. And the thing that I think kept us grounded through all that, in spite of the emotional and financial stress, is that we did know that God's presence was with us, and God really did find ways to assure us that he was.
We experienced God's love through, you know, so many different church members who, you know, would come up at church and ask us, you know, how's it going? They really reached out and encouraged us. You know, first time, you know, I lost my job, church members spent a lot of time with me because I hadn't had to work on a resume for years.
30 years.
Yeah, and so I was completely, you know, out of the loop. And you know, he spent a lot of time at church working with me, trying to get my resume up to speed and encourage me. And there was also some other people that, you know, would share my resume with their networks, hopefully help me to get a job. Some people went to lunch with me and you know, gave me encouragement and pep talked. And then, of course, you know, every Sunday we'd go to church and church members would be like, "How's the job hunt? And how are you guys doing?" And you know, they would tell us, you know, "We're praying for you," and I knew they were. And especially on Thursday, that's when the prayer group meets. And on that day, I, you know, would be looking for a job, and I just knew that there was extra prayers coming up. And then Pastor Ryan, you know, he should get paid overtime for all that he's done, for all the help and encouragement he's given to our family. And you know, he's not just a colleague of Cheryl's, but he's a real friend to the family.
And then there was a church couple that really went above and beyond with their care and generosity toward us. It really helped ease our anxiety. And I knew I was going to cry when I started talking about it because it was so meaningful to me. The wife sent cards that always seemed to look right into my soul and have the right words for what I needed to hear. And I kept those cards. One of them, on the front it said, "Glory to God," and on the inside it was stamped and it says, "Let your faith be bigger than your fear." And she wrote, "Dear Cheryl and Doug, just a note to express our appreciation for your ministry, the joy of knowing your family, and we're keeping Doug's new job in our prayers." And then the other one that she sent has got this little lamb on the front of it. You can see that. But it's this little lamb, and he's holding up a heavy weight. And it says, "The Shepherd is a great weightlifting program. No matter how heavy our cares, he is faithful to lift each one. Hope your heart feels light in the promise of his love today." And then the scripture from 1 Peter 5:7, "Let him have all your worries and cares, for he is always thinking about you and watching everything that concerns you." And she even Real personal note. Just a note to let you know I have thought about you a lot and prayed. I know what having a husband out of work means. I do know I learned something. Don't try to be his Holy Spirit. Boy, did I ever need to hear that. Said it's never easy since they are our security. Of course, we know the Lord is our real security. May God continue to sustain you, and He will. That just meant so much to me. It could have come straight out of Psalm 62 for us at the time.
Just wanted to say, you know, thanks for listening to our story, and that we hope that it, you know, helps anybody who might be going through a tough time. Thank you.
Thanks for all your support. Love you guys.
This most sacred time of our worship service, this time that we come together for communion, this sharing in the sacred act of remembrance through bread and through cup. This morning I want to share with you as some thoughts for us, actually two prayers written by Doug Skinner in his book entitled At the Lord's Table, Communion Prayers. Starts off with this one for the bread. He writes, as we gather here at your table this morning, loving God, to break bread and remember Jesus Christ and Him crucified, open our eyes to see clearly our differences. We don't look alike, we don't think alike, we don't act alike. In fact, the only thing that draws us together in this community and that holds us together in relationship is your great love for us, shown so clearly in Jesus Christ. And so as we share together this bread of remembrance, thanksgiving, and presence, draw us more tightly in the Spirit's tether, that bound to you by heart, we might be better bound to one another by hands that serve, by arms that uplift and support, and by backs that gladly bear one another's burdens. And for the cup, as we drink from this cup here this morning, which represents to us the lifeblood of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, poured out so freely for us, giving and forgiving God, let it do its work of making us spiritually one. We've made our way to this table from different directions and by different paths. But this morning we all stand here side by side, seeking the same thing at the same time. We are not different in what we need, and we are not different in what we hope. And so in this moment of Holy Communion, as we taste the sweetness of this drink, let us also experience the sweetness of your Spirit that makes us glad both to be here and to be here together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so as we gather together for this sacred feast, wherever you find yourself on this Sunday morning, invite us to remember that night when Jesus was in the upper room and he took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." And later that same evening after supper, he took the cup saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins." Today, my friends, as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, let us do so in remembrance of him.
One of our church members passed along a meditation that she'd read in the Upper Room devotional, and I just want to share part of it today for our stewardship. It's written by Joanne Fleck of Oregon, and she said, "When my husband and our 2.5-year-old great-grandson Carson returned from a walk one morning, Carson handed me what was left of a rose. Apparently, it was already wilted when he found it, and on the way home, all but one rather sad-looking petal had fallen off. In spite of that, I valued it as much as I would a perfect rose fresh from a florist shop, because it was given from a person I love. That's the way it is when we offer whatever we have to God with all our love. In Luke 21, verses 1 through 4, Jesus took notice when a poor woman gave her 2 small coins to the temple treasury. When we give our time, talents, and money to God, it's precious in God's eyes. What we have to offer may seem less than what others have to give, but instead of comparing our gifts to others, God measures only the love with which we give them. With these thoughts in mind, may we lovingly share of our tithes and offerings so that God's love is shared with others.
Ooh, ooh, I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the wind as they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. Stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. Stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock.
As we close this time of worship together, hear now these words. Like a rock, God is under our feet. Like a roof, God is over our heads. Like the horizon, God is beyond us. Like water in a pitcher, God is within us and in the pouring out of us. Like a pebble in the sea, we are in God. Let us go out and change our world as God has changed our lives. Go in peace. Amen.